In this video, we continue our study of electric dipoles by examining what happens to an electric dipole in a constant electric field. So it turns out that the net force on the dipole is always going to be zero. And that's because it experiences two electric forces that are equal in magnitude but opposite in direction on our positive and negatively charged ends of the dipole. So the net force might be zero, but the torque is not. As we can see in the animation, these two opposite forces are actually twisting the dipole. In other words, they exert a torque on the dipole, and this is always in a direction that attempts to align the dipole moment with the electric field. Quick reminder here, the dipole moment is a vector pointing in the direction from minus to plus charge, and this instant we've frozen our animation at is the stable equilibrium position here. The torque is always twisting our dipole toward this orientation. Alright, so the first thing on our agenda is to derive a simple formula for that torque as a function of angle. Secondly, we can tell there's a potential energy associated with the orientation of a dipole in an electric field, because if we release it from rest, it can spontaneously give us rotational kinetic energy as a result of this torque. And in this animation, we're showing how it actually speeds up if we release it from rest near the unstable equilibrium point. It reaches a maximum speed as it passes through the stable equilibrium point, and then it continues to oscillate with this ongoing exchange between potential and kinetic energy. So that's the second thing on our agenda. We want a compact formula for the potential energy of a dipole in a constant electric field, again as a function of angle measured with respect to the field. Finally, we're going to put our new formulas for torque and potential energy into practice by solving an example problem with specific numbers at the end of the video. All right, so we get things started with our torque analysis of a dipole that's oriented with an angle of theta with respect to the electric field direction. And we can see we have charges of plus Q and minus Q on this dipole. Then the electric force magnitude is the same on each of these charges. That's Q times E. But for the positive charge, that points in the same direction as electric field. And for the negative charge, it points opposite the direction of electric field. So those two forces are both responsible for contributing to a total clockwise torque on this dipole. And that torque is attempting to twist the dipole toward the stable equilibrium position where the dipole moment is aligned with the electric field. The last thing I want to mention in the diagram is that we're showing a distance of little d between the two charges. So all we have to do here is figure out the net torque exerted by these two forces. And that's really going to be just twice the torque exerted by one of these forces, by symmetry. And there's actually a really useful trick to getting this done in the simplest possible way. We can either compute the torque by looking at the perpendicular component of force multiplied by lever arm, or we can look at the entire force and just take the perpendicular component of the lever arm. And in this case, it's a bit easier to just take our entire force and then figure out what's the perpendicular component of the lever arm to that center of mass that we're rotating around. So there's the perpendicular lever arm, and that's going to be just d over 2, half the distance between the two charges, that's the hypotenuse of this little right triangle, so that's d over 2, times the sine of theta. So the torque due to our positive charge is just going to be the total force, that's q times e, multiplied by the perpendicular component of the lever arm, which is a d over 2 sine theta. Now by symmetry, the torque exerted by the force on the negative charge is going to be exactly the same thing, and both of them are contributing in the clockwise direction. So the net torque on this dipole is just twice the value given by the torque on the positive charge, and this gives me qed times sine theta. Now we're going to clean this up in a really common way that we use for dipoles. Recall that the dipole moment is Q times D. So we can write this as P times E times the sine of the angle between them. So that's usually all we're interested in when we're computing the torque on an electric dipole, but we can rephrase this in terms of vectors. So recall that torque is actually a vector, and we use a right-hand rule to figure this out. If I curl the fingers of my right hand in the clockwise direction, in order to go along with this clockwise torque, that means my thumb is pointing into the page. And that's the formal direction of the vector torque. And then on the right-hand side, I see P times E times the sine of the angle between them. Well, that's the magnitude of a cross product. if I take the dipole moment, remember that points from the negative charge to positive charge direction, and I cross that into the electric field vector, then I sweep the fingers of my right hand from the dipole moment direction to the electric field direction, which forces my thumb to point into the page. So that magnitude of PE sine theta is taken care of with the cross product. And it's really nice the way this works out. The direction is also the same as the formal direction of the torque. So that's really the most complete formula for the torque exerted on a dipole in a constant electric field. Torque is given by P crossed into E. But again, what we need for most practical cases is just the magnitude of that, which is P times E times the sine of the angle between them. Okay, next we want to find a formula for the potential energy of a dipole. And the basic idea of this process is the same as finding any other potential energy function. We have to look at a change in position for the system and compute the work done by our conservative force, which is the electric force in this case. So we've started with some initial orientation of theta 1 and allowed the dipole to rotate all the way down to a final angle of theta 2. And again, we want the work done by the electric force here, and then we can relate that to a change in a potential energy function. So we can start by thinking about an infinitesimal work increment along this path. And we recall that a contribution to work is not just given by force through distance. We can also talk about torque through an angle. So dW, the contribution to work here, is given by tau d theta. But we just figured out a nice formula for the magnitude of the torque. That's P times E times the sine of theta. And then we have our d theta hanging around. Now at this point, there's a really tricky thing in our derivation. And I'm going to go ahead and fix this after we get our work integral set up, because I think it's easier to explain in that context. Our total work then is going to be the sum of all the work contributions from the initial to final state. So it's the integral of dW. If we then plug in W as a function of theta, I have a PE, both constants by the way, times sine theta, that's our variable expression, times d theta. Then our limits of integration are going to be theta 1 for our starting angle and theta 2 for our finishing angle. Now what's slightly wrong with this setup is that our theta is actually decreasing. And this means d theta is going to be a negative contribution. In other words, this is one of those cases where we actually set this up as a backwards integral. So this backwards integral problem happens pretty frequently in derivations in electricity and magnetism. You need to recognize when a quantity should be positive and correct it if it's coming out negative. So all we do is put a minus sign out in front, and we say, hey, that integrand should be a positive number because I know the electric field is doing a small amount of positive work over this small increment of angle. So with that correction done, now we can just put our math hats on and guess the antiderivative of this thing. And the antiderivative of sine theta is negative cosine theta. So I end up with a PE times the cosine of theta, then evaluated from theta 1 to theta 2. And so we get a PE cosine theta 2 minus PE cosine theta 1. And just to loop back on that plus and minus sign issue for a second here, the cosine of theta 2 is clearly a larger number than the cosine of theta 1. Because remember, the cosine corresponds to an x component here, so a smaller angle is going to have a bigger cosine. In other words, I can tell in my final calculation of work that the work done by my electric field came out to a positive number, which I knew it had to. So now we're confident we got all the sine issues worked out correctly. Now, how do we take this work and relate to a potential energy function? Recall that the work done by a conservative force is equal to the negative of the change in a potential energy function. So what I need to do is say that this work calculation that I got out of that integral is equal to the negative change in some function, and then we'll figure out what that function is. So the negative of a change in the potential energy is equal to this expression we obtained. Now in that expression, theta 2 is the final angle, and theta 1 is the initial angle, and I want to keep them in that order because final minus initial, that's what we mean by delta. But I am going to get that minus sign over to the right-hand side. So I have delta U is negative PE cosine theta 2 minus negative PE. So instead of writing it as a plus, I decided to just highlight what's going on here by keeping my double negative. And in that second term, I have a minus PE cosine theta 1. So that's my change in potential energy, which means this first term must be U2. That's my final potential energy. And then I have minus my second term, which is U1. So observing that our final potential energy is given by negative PE cosine theta 2, and our initial is negative PE cosine theta 1, it's not hard to see what our potential energy function should be in general. U is going to be negative PE times the cosine of theta, which means the expression in the previous line is telling us final potential energy minus initial potential energy. So there's our potential energy function, but there's a couple more things I want to point out. First of all, using this representation of potential energy for a dipole has automatically chosen for us a reference point where the potential energy is zero. And it's not theta equals zero, it's the angle that makes the cosine function equal to zero, and that's pi over 2. So if we just put in a reference line in our diagram, that's our zero potential energy configuration. And actually the dipole we're looking at in this diagram has a negative potential energy right now. And if I rotate counterclockwise all the way past vertical, that's going to be a positive potential energy orientation. Now, the second thing I want to do is analogous to what we did with the torque formula. There's a formal way to represent this formula as a vector equation. Now, the potential energy is a scalar function, so I'm not talking about a vector on that side of the equation. What I'm talking about is this PE cosine theta. That can be represented as a dot product. So remember, if I dot two vectors together, P and E in this case, I get the product of their two magnitudes multiplied by the cosine of the angle between them. So there's the vector representation of the potential energy of an electric dipole interacting with a constant electric field. Finally, we work an example where we get to plug in some numbers for a specific electric dipole. So we're told this electric dipole has a length of 1 nanometer and a charge magnitude of 0.1 E. Recall that E is the elementary charge. That's the charge magnitude on a proton or electron, and that's 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. And we're told this thing is oriented at 40 degrees with respect to an electric field that has a strength of 10 to the 4th newtons per coulomb. So in part A, we're asked to compute the dipole moment, and we'll start with the magnitude of the dipole moment. That's Q times D, but we can also interpret this question as the vector dipole moment. So we'll do that after we're done getting the magnitude. So we sum in our charge here, that's 0.1 times E, which is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs, and then multiply by D, the charge separation distance, and 1 nanometer is 10 to the negative 9 meters. And when we run the numbers on this, we get 1.6 times 10 to the negative 29 coulomb meters. Now, if we're talking about the vector dipole moment, we just have to add direction to that. So that's 40 degrees with respect to the horizontal. So we can just write that as 1.6 times 10 to the negative 29 coulomb meters at 40 degrees with respect to the horizontal. Or if you want to get really fancy, you could say 40 degrees north of east. Now in parts B and C, we compute the torque on the dipole and the potential energy of the dipole. So recall that the torque magnitude, that's going to be P times E times the sine of theta. And we already got P, that's the dipole moment. So 1.6 times 10 to the negative 29 coulomb meters. And then our electric field strength is 10 to the 4th newtons per coulomb. And our angle is 40 degrees. And when we run the numbers on this to three significant digits, we get 1.03 times 10 to the negative 25th. And then our units, after these coulombs cancel, come out to newton meters, which are the familiar units of torque. Now, torque is also technically a vector, so we should include a direction on our answer. But rather than the formal vector direction, it makes the most sense to just say clockwise. Finally, in part C, we have the potential energy calculation. And that's negative P times E times the cosine of theta. So we plug in our dipole moment, our field magnitude, and the cosine of the angle. And rounding to three significant digits again, this gives me negative 1.23. times 10 to the negative 25th. And we carefully check our units here. The coulombs cancel and I end up with newton meters again. But this time my newton meters mean something different. Back in part B, my newton meters were giving me a torque. That's a force exerted through a lever arm. Now the interpretation is energy, a force acting through a distance or a torque acting through an angle. So these newton meters are joules. And the final point I want to make is that that potential energy is negative. Remember that our definition of potential energy for an electric dipole automatically chose for us a zero reference, and that's when the dipole is perpendicular to the electric field. And with our dipole rotated to angles that are smaller than 90 degrees, we're looking at a negative potential energy. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.